KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
I'm John Lesher, CNBC Radio. The Dow soared 320 points, the Nasdaq 67, and the S&P 524. Stocks rose with other markets as worries about trade tensions between the U.S. and the rest of the world went on the back burner. A better-than-forecast June jobs report on Friday and the expectation for strong earnings reports from nearly every sector of corporate America in the upcoming weeks also helped to support stocks. Financial companies are forecast to be one of the better-performing areas of the market. Analysts have penciled in 25% growth for their earnings from a year ago. Helen of Troy shares were up 15% after the consumer products company reported stronger revenue for the spring, with especially strong growth in online sales. Dr. Pepper and the coffee maker Keurig Green Mountain merged today. The new company is called Keurig Dr. Pepper. Again, stocks started the week with a rally. John Lesher, CNBC Radio.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, U.S. Tax Shield can help you take back control. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Our team of tax attorneys can stop collections and get you protected. U.S. Tax Shield offers a price protection guaranteed quote to get you protected today. U.S. Tax Shield is A-plus rated with the BBB, so call 800-466-9625. U.S. Tax Shield, 800-466-9625.
Attention all authors. Page Publishing is looking for authors. Have you written a book and want to get it published? Page Publishing will get your book into bookstores and for sale online at Amazon, Apple iTunes, and other outlets. They handle all aspects of the publishing process for you. Printing, cover art, publicity, copyright, and editing. Call 800-501-3689 now for your free author submission kit. That's 800-501-3689 for your free author submission kit. Again, 800-501-3689.
Attention all business owners. Join See's Candies, Big Lots, Dollar Tree, and the Spunky Steer at the Tri-City Shopping Center in Redlands. Availability is now open for restaurants, retail, and more. Located between Alabama and the Tennessee exits where the 10 and the 210 meet, your company can be a part of over 60 retail shops, restaurants, and local businesses. The Tri-City Shopping Center is zoned for multi-use, so call today and schedule an appointment. Ask for Chris Beauchamp or John Jennings, 951-684-4400. The Tri-City Shopping Center in Redlands. Redlands, the mall with a heart.
This segment of broadcasting brought to you by Tender Hearts TLC Incorporated. Tender Hearts, the helping hands for your loved ones, where they understand it can be difficult to find time in your already busy schedule to attend to all the needs of your aging loved one. Tender Hearts will be there for your loved one when you can't be. Tender Hearts TLC helps your aging loved ones stay in their home as they specialize in tender, loving, 24-hour service, including transportation to doctor's appointments, medication reminders, meal preparation, light housekeeping, and assistance with activities of daily living such as hygiene and grooming, orientation, and companionship. We thank Tender Hearts for their support of this station, Tender Hearts TLC, where they don't just care for your loved one, they give them tender, loving care. For more info, you can reach them at 909-528-9759. That's 909-528-9759 for Tender Hearts TLC.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-643-6931 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-643-6931 to take your call now. Call 1-800-643-6931. That's 1-800-643-6931. Again, 1-800-643-6931.
Whether you swing a hickory shaft mashie niblick or the latest titanium hybrid, golf is your game, and the Boy Scouts need you. To be specific, the California Inland Empire Council of the Boy Scouts of America need your help in joining them for their 10th annual Golf Classic at Los Serranos Golf Club in Chino Hills on Friday, August 10th. A continental breakfast and a lunch are included, and we tee off at 7:45 a.m. Proceeds will help to offer young people responsible fun and adventure.
KCAA, where every day is a great day.
It's For the People with Doug.
I
know your political view. In fact, I often say I don't have a political view. Sometimes I agree with the Democrats. Sometimes I agree with the Republicans.
I do too.
I don't make any judgments, but I know this is going to be a matter of great political significance for a long, long time because all these candidates are young.
Yeah.
They're going to shape the course of the judicial system for a long, long time.
That's the problem. I mean, you know, when you got two nominees from Trump, you know, one already confirmed and then this one, very conservative. You know, I don't know how I feel about that. I mean, I feel bad for women. I feel bad for...
Why? Why do you feel bad for women?
Well, I think Roe versus Wade is going to be overturned. I think women...
Why do you think that?
Because it's a conservative... it's going to be a conservative. And basically, from the records of these four nominees, supposed four nominees, that they all have weighed in on the side of dismantling Roe versus Wade.
I don't think they went quite as far as saying that. I know that some have basically indicated that they would not necessarily follow precedent. And that's the key issue here, whether or not these justices, now that there'll be 5-4 on the conservative side, whether they're going to change any law or accept it as what it is. And that's a big difference between saying I'm going to... None of these candidates or nominees are going to say that they would vote for or against Roe versus
Wade. Of course they're not going to say it, but
they absolutely are not. I guarantee you that they're not going to say that.
Of course they're not, but don't you think the Senate's going to push them on it? I mean, don't you think the senators are going to push them on it? And I mean, somebody, one of them's going to, you know, one of them or all of them, most of them are going to say, hey, what's your views on this? Do you think women have the right to have abortions?
I'm not so sure those questions really ever get answered with a direct response.
Of course they won't.
And there's an interesting political paradigm here, because if the Republicans lose one senator and the Democrats stay together, that means any nominee is not going to get approved. But if you take that versus the Democratic senators that are running for re-election in red states, and they perceive that a vote against the nominee is going to cost them a re-election, it's going to be rock and hard place for some of those people.
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting to see how it... I mean, whoever the nominee is, it's going to be a conservative nominee. Like I said, I don't think it really affects me one way or the other, but if it's going to affect gay rights, it's going to affect women, it's going to affect a lot of immigration laws. I think there's going to be a lot of things that it's going to affect a lot of people that are trying to battle for their rights.
Well, you know, I look at things in an analytical way as opposed to a political way, because the reality is going to be that this court will shape a lot of the direction that we go in for a long time. And the reality is conservative does not mean bad. It doesn't mean you're going to change everything. Conservatives tend to be more steady in what they do and holding basically to their beliefs in their belief system. I'm not so sure they're so quick to make changes. I think the liberals generally make more changes than the conservatives.
Of course they do.
So you don't really know where it's going to go. It's 5-4. I mean, that's what it's going to be.
Yeah.
Not really a whole lot has changed when you think about it. Scalia was an arch conservative.
Right.
He replaced him with an arch conservative.
Yes.
So that didn't change anything. Kennedy was a kind of a waffler.
Yes.
Sometimes he was here, sometimes he was there. He was bright, he was honest, he was hardworking, he was intellectual. But for the most part, he took the conservative viewpoint. So replacing him with somebody, unless they're farther to the right, isn't going to make a whole lot of difference.
It's going to be interesting to see what happens.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah.
I wonder what the people in the audience are thinking. what do they want to see what happened? You know, he's appointed a lot of women to major posts, the head of the CIA, the head of Homeland Security. These are women. Betsy DeVos is a woman. She's in charge of education.
Doing a great job, by the way.
So I don't think I have no comments.
I know, I'm just messing around.
My kids are too old to be back in middle school or high school, so
it doesn't matter to me either. So.
And my granddaughter's too young so far.
Listen, I mean, like I said, it's going to shape the Supreme Court the way it's going to really shape American life for many, many years to come. So it's going to be a very hard-fought battle. I think there's going to be something really bizarre happen in the next month or two. I really don't want, I'll talk about it on my radio show, but I really believe that there's going to be something bizarre that's going to block this nomination.
Well, that's not so far-fetched when you think about it. It's a political battle for survival for some.
Yes.
I don't think it's as significant as a lot of people are making
really?
It out to be.
Really? You're a judge.
Well, the bottom line is if you follow the Constitution, which is what we're supposed to do, and you accept the principles of law that have been established by what's called stare decisis, which means precedent, maybe nothing is going to change. Will there be some changes in some things? I'm sure that there will be. What's interesting to me as a lawyer is this appointee, whoever it is, may be sitting on a case that involves the indictment of a president, the president that appointed him or her, and may very well be making decisions as to indictments, privileges, and things of that nature. It seems to me a little bit of a conflict, although I don't think it's going to go anywhere in terms of the argument. But realistically, from an analytical standpoint, judges shouldn't be hearing cases in which they've had an interest, or they were appointed by somebody, or they do business with somebody, or anything of that nature. But that's what's going to happen, because that's where this is going. And you have a parallel track. The investigation, the Mueller investigation and all that, it's going to end up in this court. So I think
Isn't that crazy?
Trump has got to recognize that, too, and think, well, whoever I'm appointing, are they going to be providing are they going to provide a noose for me, or are they going to just give me a pass?
That's going to be crazy.
I studied political science in college, and this is a very interesting time. But what I want to talk about today,
yes,
because people ask me about judges all the time, figure, you know, what is it like?
Here comes
and
a judge.
How does it happen? How do you get to be a judge? I'm going to talk about today. I generally don't get into personal things, but I thought maybe it would be a good opportunity to kind of lay a foundation. That's a legal term, lay a foundation for some of the things that I say. So maybe it has credibility, maybe it doesn't. But one of the reasons we got a title is so we could talk from some sense of authority.
Right.
And so I'm going to answer some questions that people have been asking me about that. But first, I think it's important to recognize, where did judges come from? I mean, you don't inherit the job because your parents were judges. There's only really three ways you can become a judge: state court. So I'm going to talk about the difference between the state court and the federal court, so the audience will have a sense of where all this emanates from.
My dad actually ran to be a judge.
He did?
Yeah, he lost. But he did run.
Well, you know.
obviously. I guess that he was
a
judge.
Well, no, I remember when I was in law school, yeah. I was on the phone bank calling for some judge who I didn't even know.
Right.
But somebody said he was a good guy and we should make calls and get people out to vote.
Uh-huh.
And that is a part of it. Some of the people that have been elected have been unmitigated disasters.
Right.
But they get elected because they put some money in. One of my colleagues spent $50,000 to get reelected to his judicial post where he's been sitting for 20 years.
Wow.
But he had to put up all his money because some guy took him on.
Yeah.
And they were spending money. So he had to spend money.
Of course. That's the way it works.
And he hasn't stopped complaining about it ever since.
Well, he's gotten a job for, 25 years? What's he bitching about?
Well, he just got a six-year term.
Okay.
So he'll be close to 90 by that time. If he still wants to sit, all the more power to him.
Why would you want to do that at 90? That's what I want to know.
I'm not so sure why a lot of people want to do it at 70.
Exactly, Judge.
But you know, there are so many different degrees of what judges are. They really run the gamut from justice of the peace.
Right.
You know, in West Virginia, I remember because I was going to school in Pittsburgh, we used to drive to West Virginia, and there was a little spot where the cop would hide behind
This segment of programming sponsored by CyberTime Network Communications. How's your internet? Feeling boxed in with the high costs of the internet? Ready for a better internet service? Then you're ready for CyberTime. Yes, there's an alternative to those big corporate internet service providers. It's CyberTime Network Communications. CyberTime is so good, they provide all the connectivity for this radio station. Crisp, cool, fast, and sleek. CyberTime uses the latest leading-edge microwave technology. No wires, no cables, no sharing, and they're able to offer clients a safe, reliable, public or private network that fits almost any budget size. And several cities rely on CyberTime's microwave private network for their most critical mission applications. Get connected. Stay connected. Get smart. Get CyberTime. You can Google, text, or call CyberTime Network Communications at 909-795-9559. That's 909-795-9559.
Do you want exposure for your business or organization? Check out Digital Network Advertising. Digital Network Advertising is where businesses display your ad inside their building. You can choose your marketing sites or jump on the DNA system and advertise with all participants. Your slide holds the virtual billboard for 14 seconds and is displayed 3 times an hour. It's a novel way to be seen, be discovered, and to be remembered. Digital Network Advertising. Networks in Redlands and Yucaipa. Call 909-222-9293 for introductory pricing. That's 909-222-9293.
Lifestyles Unlimited is the real estate investor education and mentoring group that is
whether judges are
by
activists or not. In terms of putting together a court, this time is not any different than it's been for 75 years. Because if you're a student of history, you know that Franklin Delano Roosevelt packed or tried to pack the Supreme Court with a bunch of liberals. Didn't work. Or he worked to some degree. He got some of those appointments made.
Right.
This is just the opposite side of the coin. Whoever's in power is using that power to put in people that are going to be consistent with their views, and that's what the political issues are. Although I don't think that the last appointments from Obama were really people who were political animals of any kind. There were two women that he appointed, seemed to be fairly intellectual, had no real baggage going along with it. The last person with baggage was Clarence Thomas.
Right.
They went through that whole thing with the Coke bottle and the
Anita Hill.
And all of that.
Oh, that was ridiculous.
But for the most part, most of the
Who nominated him? Was that Reagan or Bush?
Nominated
Clarence Thomas. Yeah.
I believe it was Bush.
It was Bush, right?
Yeah. I think it was the first Bush.
The first
not
Bush?
Not the burning Bush, but the first Bush.
So that goes with the Coke can and the...
Well, you know how that happened? I happen to know how that happened. He was from Missouri.
Okay.
And the senator from Missouri was a somewhat politically important person and basically blew in the president's ear about this guy. And that's how it happened. In fact, it's interesting. I heard today that one of the candidates, Hardiman, one of the potential nominees, was recommended by Trump's sister.
Are you kidding me?
So I don't know what that
means.
Oh,
my God.
If you're hanging out with the people over there, I guess you get it, you know, you're getting recognized. But if you're getting into appointments, an appointment by the president to the Supreme Court, to the United States Circuit Court of Appeals, and there are a number of them around the country, and even the federal district court have to be approved by the Senate. Most of the time, it just slides right through, although we've had a number of instances where people have been rejected. Bork, if you remember Bork.
Robert Bork. And, you know, he was part of the Nixon fiasco. Remember that?
I don't.
Yes, he was.
But I know he was not the first one that was knocked off that didn't get the appointment either. And so a lot of this is really about politics. But the president makes the nomination. It's a lifetime appointment. There's a lot of debate about whether or not these judges should be appointed for life or not. The concept is life is better because they will not be motivated by making decisions looking forward to whether or not they can keep their jobs. Lifetime appointment means lifetime appointment. The other side of the coin is it's not a good thing because they become arrogant. They do whatever they want. You know, no real risk of losing their job, although they can be impeached like any other major political office holder. They can be impeached, but it's a pretty hard process. I can't remember. I think one justice has been impeached.
Judge,
maybe two.
Can I ask you a question? As a judge, do you think somebody in the Supreme Court should, you know, be on the bench until they decide to retire 30, 40, 50 years? I mean, I don't like this thing with the Congress and the Senate and the Supreme Court, where they're just sitting there for years and years and years, getting renominated as far as the Senate and the House of Representatives. But these Supreme Court justices, I mean, they're going to be sitting there 30, 40, 50 years. Don't you think there should be some term limit or something, like 20 years?
Well, that's the same argument about life terms. There are a lot of conservatives who would like to see Ruth Bader Ginsburg crump or disappear or something like that, so they get another appointment.
Right.
But she's competent. She presses 150 pounds, and she's out there at the gym, and she's running, and she's healthy, and why should she quit? As I get older, I become much more defensive about age-related matters.
We do.
Well, you know, because I was thinking, you know, I practiced full-time for over 50 years. I mean, that's a significant period of time.
Yes.
And this is my 10th year on the bench, and I'm still doing it. In fact, I checked this morning just to see what my calendar looked like for tomorrow. I got 18 cases tomorrow.
18 cases?
18 cases.
We're in Ventura?
Yes.
Wow.
18 cases. That's
not too bad.
No, that's very good. That's very light. I've had days when I had 25 to 30 cases in Ventura. When I was covering courts in Los Angeles County, when I covered 15 courts, I had cases sometimes 40, 50. And then one case I talked about in one of the previous shows, I had 86 cases in one day in Inglewood.
Wow. Now, let me ask you, Judge. Okay, so you have 18 cases tomorrow in Ventura County, small claims. So do you, like, tonight, will you go through the cases, or will you wait till you get to the courtroom to go through the cases?
I don't have the files until I get to court.
Okay, so you don't have the files.
I get there a little early. In fact, people always say they're sitting in the audience, and they're just sitting and sitting and waiting for the judge to show up, right?
Yeah.
They think we're out there doing something or
you're
whatever.
Having coffee and bagels.
Not actually reading the files.
Okay.
I learn about each of the cases by looking at the files. And the judicial assistant, used to be called the clerk, now it's called the judicial assistant, basically checks the people in with the bailiff. And so they come in to me before I come out, and they will say at case number one, number two, both parties are here. Case number three, only the plaintiff is here. Case number four, nobody's appeared.
Right.
So I know, and what I do is I take the files physically, and I separate them from the appearances and the non-appearances. And I, as my custom, I put the contested cases, both parties present, where I think the issues might take a little bit more time. I usually put them at the end of the calendar. I get rid of the continuances if there are any. I get rid of the no-shows if I have those.
Right.
I dismiss them without prejudice, allowing for a refiling if the appropriate circumstances exist. I set what's called a prove-up. Prove-up is where the defendant doesn't appear, the plaintiff does, but the plaintiff still has to prove to the court that there's legal basis for their claim. For example, and I've used this one before on prior shows, if I look at the stamp in the top right-hand corner of the complaint, it says the date that the complaint was filed. And by looking in the body of the pleading, the form that they file, if it says that the defendant breached the agreement, if it's a contract case, an oral contract, and it's been more than 2 years, that case is too late.
Right.
So the plaintiff,
statute of limitations.
Plaintiff loses, and the defendant's not even there.
Right.
And that happens. I've done that more than once because I do check. And I am assuming that my colleagues do the same thing because we look for the technical reasons. There are rules.
Right.
And if it doesn't fit the rule for that particular case, that's where the decision is made.
All right, let me ask you a question. So let's say a plaintiff shows up, the defendant doesn't show up. Do you question the plaintiff, like, you know, cross-examine them at all, or are you about the complaint or anything like that, and the defendant's not there, or you just award the decision to the plaintiff?
Well,
as long as they filed within the statute of limitations.
Well, I do question the plaintiffs. That's why it's called a prove-up. We've talked about this case many times, and we still chuckle every time. This is the $1,000 check that the lady got, the exotic dancer.
He didn't show up?
The defendant did not show up.
Oh, really?
Did not show up, but I did ask her some questions. I was kind of curious anyway.
Of course you were.
Because, sometimes it's pretty dry, you know. You're listening to somebody asking for their security deposit back. Not a lot of excitement.
Right.
But this one looked kind of interesting, you
exotic
know.
Exotic dancing.
Yeah, she danced at people's homes.
Right.
and she didn't get paid. Well, she got paid with a stiff check. No, no pun intended.
But you know, so you're questioning her, and he's not even there.
That she was not, but I keep him short, depending on how big the calendar is, because I, in the courtroom, straight ahead from the bench, on the back wall over the door to get in and out is the clock. And so I'm looking at the clock while I'm looking at the people.
Right.
So I know, okay, it's 11 o'clock. I got five more cases to do. What kind? These are the disputed cases. So I got to make it a little quicker. I got to make sure I get finished. Because the agreement that I made was we're done at 12 o'clock for the morning sessions so that the clerk and the bailiff can go to lunch.
An hour and a half.
Hour and a half.
You know. Well, I'm saying, I'm just stating it what is, the courtroom is.
No, that's the rules. It's an hour and a half.
It's an hour and a half. It's a courtroom.
Oh, but on the other hand, I know of colleagues who have sat through lunch, who have taken cases and they didn't finish it at 12. They keep on going. They'll go to 12:30.
Okay.
And so, you know, it depends on how
most
how serious you take.
Most protocol. Come on.
Well, on, most Judge. People are out the door by 12:01.
Exactly. Come on, and not in there until 1:29. You know.
Well, you know, I have lunch with a judge friend of mine, usually once a week.
Yeah.
And we are about 10 minutes from the courthouse, and he looks at the watch. If it's 20 after, he's up and he's out. He's going to get back there by 1:30.
Well, good for
he's
him.
He's pretty good about it. He doesn't.
What about you?
He.
1:45.
I move slowly. In fact, my wife always says, you know, you always moved slowly. Now you're even moving more slowly. I said, but no, I just move at my pace.
Your pace.
My pace. But I'm cool with the people. I really am. Yeah. I take it very, very seriously. In fact, when we talk about why I did it, you know, why I took the appointment, it was mainly because I cared about the people. And that's why we have this show called For the People. Because what I do is helping the public.
You do.
And I take it so seriously. Sometimes I take the work home. I actually do. I take it under submission, and I go home and do my own research because we don't get a clerk in small claims, a research attorney. We get him in other courts where you rely on that because the calendars are so big, you can't do all your own research.
Right.
Like when I was sitting in unlawful detainers, a lot of those cases, demurs and things like that, were basically reviewed by the research attorney, and they'd write a little – you know, two-paragraph opinion as to what they thought should be done. And for the most part, they were experienced. We pretty much followed their suggestions, and it was relatively quick. But when I was sitting in limited jurisdiction, regular civil litigation, you'd get files sometimes would be 4 or 5 inches thick. You can't spend the time, but of course you have to.
Right.
You really have to sacrifice other things to get to what that calendar looks like. As I told you before, we used to have it lined up on the wall next to the window, the whatever calendar we had. And you could see when you walked in, oh, look at this. It's about 9 inches high. You know what you got to do that day.
That's a lot of work.
But let me get back to the federal appointments because it's important.
All right.
They get appointed for life. They get approved by the Senate, not the House, only the Senate. And they're there forever. Now, I personally, and I've said it before, don't love federal court.
Right.
An old friend of mine who's now passed on to the jury in the sky. I'm not so sure he did that great up there, but whatever. But I got along with him pretty well.
Jeez.
He once said to me, and he was the most disliked judge in the building.
What'd he say?
He said, judges, some of them think they got anointed instead of appointed. And that's really true. Some judges take this so seriously, it becomes such an ego thing about being right or who they want to win. Whatever, that justice is really not done, and I think that's awful. This happens all the time.
All right, Judge, we got to take a break.
Okay.
All right, it's Judge Herb Dodell, For the People. Get his book from the Trench of the Bench, Amazon.com, and we'll be back right after this.
NBC Talk Radio, 1050 AM, KCAA.
In his book, From the Trench to the Bench, Judge Herb Dodell demystifies the legal system, including both civil and criminal. The lawyers, the judges, and the process. As a judge, former deputy district attorney, and criminal defense attorney, he knows the legal system. He has the inside information that you need to pick a lawyer, and he's here to give it to you. No matter what you're facing that makes you think you may need a lawyer, Judge Herb will shed valuable light on your situation and reveal your best options and many secrets of how the judicial system actually works. To find out more about how the legal system really works, you can get your copy of Judge Herb Dodell's eye-opening book, From the Trench to the Bench, at Amazon.com.
So in the federal system, the Supreme Court is the highest court in the land. There's no place to go from there. Below it is the Circuit Court of Appeals. Like, we're in the Ninth Circuit here in California. And there are probably 24, 25 judges in the Circuit Court of Appeals. They, too, have to be approved by the Senate. And many of them come from the District Court, which is the trial court.
Can I ask you a stupid question?
You can ask even an intelligent one if you like.
Why the Ninth Circuit? What does the number nine have to do with anything?
Absolutely with nothing.
It's just called the Ninth. It's just divided.
The country is divided. Like the Second Circuit is in New York.
Okay. All right.
And the First District, First Circuit is somewhere else.
Okay. Well, so it goes 1 through 50 then.
No. It's up to, I think there are, my memory serves me right. I think there are either 11 or 12 circuits.
Okay, so they're all. So it's not just by state. It's
No. In fact, the Ninth Circuit covers Washington, the state of Washington, Oregon, California. I might even cover Hawaii. I'm not sure if.
Some people might be curious
Arizona
about that.
Too. Yeah. Well,
I'm always looking at. I'm always looking at like when they show that like the Supreme Court nominees are from the Ninth Circuit or the Tenth Circuit or the Second Circuit. What the hell is the circuits?
They also have reputations.
Okay.
The Ninth Circuit is considered one of the most liberal circuits in the country.
Okay.
That's going to change, because as those people move on, a couple of them died the last year or so. They're getting picked based on political considerations. The guy in the White House, McGahn, I think his name is.
McGahn.
They're vetting these people out through what's called the Federalist Society. That's a very, very conservative group. They ask all the questions that the president can't ask.
So hold on. So President Trump elects these guys, like they retire from the Ninth Circuit. He gets to pick them? Those judges?
He picks whoever he wants.
That's what I'm saying. So let's just say one of the judges from the Ninth Circuit retires. Yeah. Trump picks that person to replace.
No, once they retire, they retire.
No, but I'm saying who replaces him? Who gets the pick to replace him?
Oh, he picks the replacement.
That's what I'm saying. He gets to pick the replacement. It's just not the Supreme Court that Trump is picking. He's picking all these district judges.
It's even more pronounced because the Supreme Court, I think, granted 74 petitions one year over thousands that get it submitted. And so the real action takes place in the federal district court, which is the trial court, which is the equivalent to the superior court in California. So there's three levels in the federal court system. The district court also need to be approved by the Senate. That's the trial court. And in that court, they have magistrates who are kind of like sub-judges. There are judges who serve on a temporary basis. They're not appointed for life. And they're elected by the majority of the district court judges in that district. And so they work like a commissioner works in the superior court.
Right.
And from the district court, you go to the Court of Appeals. That's an automatic appeal if you follow all the rules, not discretionary. If you file a notice of appeal on a timely basis, you will be heard in the circuit court. The last time I was in the circuit court, was a couple of years ago. It took 2 years from the time of filing of the notice of appeal until that court ruled in our favor, mind you. 2-1, good enough. There's three. And people always ask me, do you think oral argument really makes any difference? And why do people want to be appellate judges? Well, because the appellate judges don't really deal with people. They don't. They just read briefs. All they do really is listen to oral argument, which, to my way of thinking, is mainly a waste of time. They've already decided, they've already passed around a temporary decision, or a tentative decision among the three panelists. You get a three-judge panel. Every now and again, when there's an interest that has major significance, they meet and they call en banc, meaning all of them. It's like 24 of them, whatever it is, that's en banc. Normally you get three judges, appellate court judges, and they listen to the oral argument. Sometimes you can tell who's going to win by the oral arguments. Not the arguments so much, but by the questions. The way it generally works is you go before the court and you say, we've submitted our briefs, blah, blah, blah. I will answer any questions that the court may have. You invite the questions.
Right.
And that's the hard part of being an advocate, because you don't know sometimes where those questions are coming from. I remember arguing before the California Supreme Court. There's seven in the Supreme Court of California. You need four to win. And I remember standing there shaking a little bit, I suppose. I was a little nervous. And they were asking me all kinds of questions. And I was prepared. I had stayed up the night before. I read every case, and I knew inside and out. And when they asked questions of the other guy, he was stumped for an answer in a couple of them.
Really?
Yeah, he had just been hired to do the argument before the Supreme Court. I was in the case from the very beginning.
Yeah.
So I knew the case cold. It took me 13 years to get there.
Wow.
From the time that we filed the original complaint, we were in the Court of Appeals twice. The case was tried twice, and it went all the way up to the Supreme Court. And we won 7-0. I was thrilled. All I needed was four, but we got all seven, and that case made law in California. That's called Essex versus Five Star Dye House.
What precedent did this have?
It's an insurance law dealing with insurance companies' obligations to provide a defense to their policyholders, and whether or not they were liable for attorney's fees to a winning party, even though that winning party was not their insured. Was not the policyholder. And the court held, yes, they have to pay the attorney's fees under those circumstances to an assignment made by the policyholder. And that established new law. It had been bantied around over a case called Brand versus Superior Court. So that was pretty important.
Wow, but Judge. It's pretty cool.
I always say that because I'm so proud of it. You know,
how
often do you ever get a chance to argue before the Supremes, you know? I went to a couple of their shows, but the intermediary court is the Court of Appeals.
Okay.
And in both the state and the federal. And so it works its way up. Now, in terms of the Supreme Court, it's discretionary. The court can decide to listen to an appeal or not. In the federal system, it's called a writ of certiorari. You have to petition the court for them to be interested enough in your case to be willing to even go to the next step, which is to submit briefs and things of that nature. Criminal cases is especially important because the Supreme Court decides death penalty cases all the time.
Yeah.
And you gamble, if you're a defendant on death row, with who's on that court. Conservatives tend to be affirming decisions below, and a lot of liberals are looking for reasons to set it aside. And that's what you see in a lot of these decisions. So that's the federal system. The courtrooms are very, very nice. They're beautifully wood paneled.
Of course.
Lovely. And the judge has two full-time law clerks who do most of the work.
Nice chambers.
Lovely. Lovely. Oh, some of them are really nice. It's like an apartment. You know. And some of the judges are very, very nice. They really are. A lot of them come from state courts. They get promoted from a superior court or a court of appeals and get into the federal system. By the way, people always ask me, how much do these guys get paid?
Yeah, how much do they get paid?
How much do you think that let's just take a judge in the federal district court, which is the trial court. How much do you think they make?
I'd say $125,000.
You're a little short. Well, you're not short. You're probably 5'10". But the... They get about $170,000.
$170,000.
That's what the state superior court judges make. $179,000, I think, was the last number that I saw. Supreme Court $200,000.
This Supreme Court.
Supreme Court of the United States $200,000.
$200,000. That's all they're making.
That's it.
That's not too much, actually.
And you can't take any outside income.
Yeah, of course.
It's a little bit of an illusion because in the state court, they get a lot of fringe benefits.
Yeah.
You know, medical stuff and things like that. But you can't take any jobs. You can't endorse anything. You basically,
of course
this is
not.
And you can't even take any gifts.
Of course not.
You can't even give them a box of chocolate.
Really?
Even if you tell them that Forrest Gump gave it to you. No chocolate. You get nothing.
Nothing.
Now, the state is a little different. The state is all political.
Yeah.
Well, I shouldn't say all political. There are three ways to become a judge in California. The first way is to be appointed by the governor. How does that happen? Somebody knows somebody. Or you made a contribution to somebody's candidate, and the candidate called a friend or a cousin or a sister of somebody, and it gets up to the governor's secretary, not even the governor.
Right.
And they review the applications, and whoever applies that has some clout gets the gig. They're investigated by a commission, but that's pretty rote unless they've been convicted of a felony. Most of the time it goes right through. That's the political way.
Okay.
But they're not permanent assignments. You got to run for re-election.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, okay. in the state court.
Okay.
And the second way is an election.
Yeah.
And some people are just watching to see somebody retire, and it's an open spot. And they're all gang prosecutors. If you look at the ballot, there's a very, very brief biography of what these people do. You know, deputy district attorney, deputy public defender, you know, a businessman, economist, a farmer, whatever you put down there. And they put the money in, they hire a consultant, they take out ads, they go around the neighborhood and put those signs on your front lawn, and they run for election. The problem with that politically is that most of the time when people get elected and they're not going through the establishment, the presiding judge, there is a presiding judge in every county, the presiding judge decides where you're going to sit. And for those people who know people, they get the nice cushy jobs with the nice chambers and everything else. And for those who don't, end up in traffic court. And that was the reason I didn't take a full-time appointment, by the way. I had been offered many times to go on the bench full-time, and I wasn't interested in doing it.
Because you want to sit in traffic court.
Well, I didn't want a job.
Right.
And I didn't want to be sent someplace where I didn't really want to be. Like, I know somebody who got transferred up to Antelope Valley.
Oh, my Lord.
Drives here every morning. And I didn't want a crummy court that I was going to get stuck in listening to red light tickets.
Yeah.
So I used the third method. The third method is provided by statute. Statute allows for the presiding judge in each county to appoint, as a judge, anybody that qualifies, that applies and is supported. You have to take all the tests and all of the, read all the documents and get certified.
The judge's test.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Basically, that's right. And you got to take the tests and you got to pass them. And any subject that you're going to be assigned to, you have to take that subject matter. So that's how I became somewhat of an expert in some of the subjects where I sat. Sit. So
yeah, you're sitting tomorrow for Christ's sake.
I am. Yes, I am.
18 cases.
18 cases. Well, that's a piece of cake.
So you're going to be done by noon with 18?
I will be done by noon.
And that's it?
That's it.
Your day's done.
Day is done.
That's nice.
That's it.
It's very nice,
Judge. It doesn't always happen that way. But we're, you look at the political part of it. A lot of these people just sit there for 20 years. I had a friend of mine who was basically a site judge. In other words, he was in control of one particular courthouse,
mm-hmm.
and he got into a fight with one of the other judges there. She was a piece of work. I remember her. She would fall asleep. She was terrible. He ended up in an argument with her, but she knew the presiding judge. So what happened to him? Traffic court.
Antelope Valley.
No, traffic court.
Oh, that's even worse.
So I go down, I have lunch with him. I said, what are you doing here? You hate this. He says, I hate getting up every morning. I said, then why are you here? He says, I got another year and a half to go to get my pension.
There you go.
And that's why he stayed. Stayed in traffic court. Horrible. So for me, when I made the decision, I'll tell you why I did when we get done with the break.
All right. It's Judge Herb Dodell for the people. And we'll be back. Check out his YouTube videos. Look up the judge on YouTube.
We just did a whole bunch of them.
We did. We'll be back after this. KCAA.
Did you ever meet a lawyer that was for the people? Someone who had the best interests of the people at heart. Herb Dodell has been a lawyer for more than 50 years and has been a superior court judge for 9 years, having presided over more than 9,000 cases. In this show, he will reveal the secrets of how things really work in the legal system. so you can maximize your position and benefit most when you're in trouble and need someone on your side to simplify the process for you. For more information, email the judge at askjudgeherb@gmail.com. That's askjudgeherb@gmail.com.
So the question is, why did I do it? A colleague of mine was telling me how bad things were, that they had no money in the budget to add new judges, and they were overwhelmed and overworked. And he called to my attention the statutory provision allowing the presiding judge to appoint me as a temporary judge, which is called pro tem. And so I did all of the things I was supposed to do. I took the tests. I read all the stuff. You have to go through an entire vetting process as well. They review who you are, they check your records, they check the references and whatever. But when you get appointed, you have the same powers as the regular either elected or appointed judge by the governor, with some minor exceptions like adoptions. You can't do adoptions. Never figured out why. You can't do name changes. And you can't issue search warrants.
Why can't you do the name changes?
I have
That's
no idea.
Weird. And search
no
warrants?
Idea. Yeah,
strange.
Search warrants you can't do either.
Strange.
For whatever reason. I think they were just differentiating between what used to be called the municipal court and the superior court. So in California, and in most states are the same, you have your trial court, which is called the superior court. And that here handles all kinds of things, whether it's family law, juvenile. It covers pretty much the gamut. And above that is the Court of Appeals. This is our intermediary court, where if you file a proper notice, you get it. You absolutely have a right to be heard on an appeal. And then, just as it is in the federal system, the Supreme Court of California only takes cases that it wants to take. You have to file something called a petition for hearing with the Supreme Court, and they'll either take it or not. Same basic percentage. They take about 2%, I think, of the cases that are submitted to them. And for me, I had decided that at that my age at the time, I said, you know, I've been doing this a fair amount of time. I had tried by then 90 some odd jury trials, not including the ones I was a DA. And I said to myself, you know, what can I offer to the public? Only my experience and my attitude. And so I said, you know what? It wasn't a financial issue for me because we don't get paid. I've heard 10,000 cases and never received one dime from anybody.
Oh, you mean you
I don't get paid.
You don't get paid to be a judge?
No, I don't get a dime.
What?
In fact, I'm out of pocket because when I drive to Antelope Valley, it's my gas and my car. I don't get paid back any of it.
So tomorrow when you go to work?
Free.
It's free.
I'm free.
Don't even get a lunch or anything?
No lunch. I get free parking.
How about coffee?
No coffee.
No coffee?
Free parking, though.
Free parking.
But the
That's
problem,
weird.
The problem with that is at Ventura, all the parking is free.
So That's right.
There's no perk up there. But no, I probably spent a lot of time. I've sat 500 days on the bench. So that's how I heard 10,000 cases.
I cannot believe that you don't
free.
Get paid.
I'm free.
That is
at a loss.
Wow.
But you know what? As I said in my book, when people ask me if I get paid, I get paid. I really do get paid.
Yes.
But not in money.
In what? Spirituality?
I get paid in satisfaction.
Okay.
To know that I made a difference in somebody's life in a positive way, and I try to treat people that way, to me is worth every penny of it. As long as I can afford to do it, I'm going to do it. And
I think it's good for your mind, too.
Well, I really truly enjoy the job a lot.
Yeah.
I really, really do. When I get challenging cases, I've had cases where I had to decide the constitutionality of a statute. Where would I have ever had that experience if I was just out there trying to make more money?
Right.
You know, not that I minded doing that. Not that I minded taking on challenging cases, because I've had everything from streetwalkers to first-degree murder cases.
Yeah.
And I've had a lot of...
Celebrities.
I have had that, too. But the point that they're tough to represent, by the way. Celebrities, except for Johnny Mercer, he was a real prince. For the younger people, they don't know who Johnny Mercer is. But he wrote Moon River and a lot of great
Moon
songs.
Moon River.
He was a great guy, too, by the way.
Yeah.
Really nice man.
But celebrities are a pain in the ass, huh?
Most of the time, because they call you at 3 o'clock in the morning and they expect you to drop everything.
Of course.
I ended up in London many times when I was representing one of the Rolling Stones. And
can't you say his name?
It was Nicky Hopkins, who was the fifth Rolling Stone. He was the keyboard guy.
Okay.
And he wanted me to sit there. So I sat there for like 3 months. He was paying me to sit in the back, and I was doing nothing. But he wanted to have his lawyer there. Okay, great. But the fact of the matter is a lot of celebrities think that they're so special that you should drop everything for them, and they're always right.
They walk on water, Judge. Didn't you know that?
Well, yeah, some of them do. only if it's an inch thick. They can walk on that water.
Yeah, they're not going to any caves.
It's the banana peel part.
Right, exactly.
But the bottom line really is people ask me, what's it like to be a judge? Well, you know, I like to keep the ego part of it out. I like to. But I must admit that when I first started it, I felt important.
Of course you do. You got the black robe on. Yeah, you're sitting above everybody.
And they call you. You get a lot of respect. In fact, I got a doctor's appointment one time when they had no appointments because my clerk mentioned that I was on the bench. What? All of a sudden, they had room for me.
Of course.
Had a kidney stone, and they took me right in.
Really?
Yeah, because he heard the magic words, right?
Judge.
Your Honor. I try hard not to let that get in my way. There is an element, of course, that you get along with it, and you ask yourself the question: why do these people take jobs for $179,000 a year? Not that that's not a minimum amount
of money.
But
they couldn't make five times more.
Many of these guys and gals couldn't make a living.
Really?
Yeah.
Being attorneys?
Most lawyers don't make a living. Believe it or not.
Really?
Not every lawyer makes a lot of money. The majority don't. And so they come along, or they've worked in the DA's office or the public defenders, and they're civil servants. They're prepared that this is all they're going to ever make.
Wow.
And so some of them, and I know some who are awful. Awful. They couldn't get a job, yet they're sitting on the bench now making major decisions, and I sometimes shake my head. I've told the story of the drunken judge here before.
Yeah.
I'm not going to repeat that one.
Passed on.
And some of them are just mean and nasty because they can get away with it. I think that's awful.
Do you think they're bitter because they couldn't make it and
I think so. I think
attorneys?
I think there's a jealousy factor in there, too. They see lawyers coming in with big cases.
Big
money.
And
they're going to walk out with big dough. And they're working. One guy used to say, I remember him, he said, you know, I've got 500 active files and I'm up all night. And he was moaning and groaning because the litigants were looking to make some money.
Right.
And so a lot of that is that, you know. And
a judge shouldn't be doing that.
And some of them really, like Henry Patrick Nelson, who's my old buddy, said about being anointed, some of them really feel that way. They really feel that they're so special because they got a job. That they can walk and
do whatever they want.
Go over whatever they want to do it. And many of them can't even support their, you know, family life. And they're scraping like everybody else. And so they think because you're a judge that something really special, it's a job.
Well, you know what? It's weird because when you say that, they're just, you know, they're like everyday people. But when they get up there, they're not.
Oh, they are definitely not. Oh. You know, I know some judges. After there's a federal district court judge who I went to law school with. I think he's still on the bench. And on the bench, he's a tyrant, a nasty tyrant. But if you go into chambers and you know him, you take off the robe, everything is, how's things going? And it's like you are in two entirely different worlds.
Wow.
There's one judge. Federal district court judge, senior status, meaning he's been around for 100 years. He probably has. And he's just plain nasty. He yells at everybody. He's insulting. And if you're on the wrong side of him, you know it. I was in front of him only one time, and I was on the right side. He really gave the other guy a beating, an embarrassing beating. But he does it because he can do it. And yet I went to a funeral of one of his colleagues, who I also knew, and there's the guy, the meanest, nastiest guy, crying his eyes out.
Yeah, of course.
Crying his eyes out. I said, that's, you know. But a lot of these people put the robe on, they change their personalities. And I was determined when I took this, I knew I wasn't ever going to get paid. I knew I was going to be sent to places I didn't really necessarily wanted to go. I'd be handling cases I really didn't want to be doing. But I kept saying to myself, what a great way for me to contribute back for all the things that I got. Because I had a successful practice and I did pretty well. And I said, it's time to share my experiences and my knowledge, whatever wisdom I had, to the public.
So all the small claims, judges do not get paid?
No. They get paid. I'm an exception. Well, I'm not an exception. There are those of us who carry the excess loads. In other words, in Van Nuys, for example, there are two judges doing small claims, both of whom are full-time, one of whom is a colleague of mine. And that's all he does is small claims.
Right.
And he's pretty good at it.
He gets paid.
He gets his regular salary.
What do they make?
179.
Oh, those guys make 179.
Yeah.
That's not bad.
The Court of Appeals makes a few bucks more.
Yeah.
Not a lot more, a few bucks more. The Supreme Court Chief Justice in California is probably the highest paid. She gets $250.
$250.
She gets $250, I think.
Yeah.
I think the other associate justices get $200. At the best of my record, I hadn't looked at it well. But I also looked at Utah and Mississippi. You'd be shocked what these people are getting paid.
100 and thou? 100,
112. God, 91.
It's crazy.
And so that's who's deciding your future.
Wow. You're making more money than they are. They must be upset. They have to take that into consideration, I would think.
But some of the judges have gone off into settlements, become settlement judges. They don't hear cases. They just settle cases.
Right.
And some of them are truly properly motivated. They're good at it. They understand the system. Many of them came from private practice. And they're very, very good, and you get that as part of being a litigant.
It's scary, Judge. You're telling us the inside stuff that nobody even knows about.
You know, one of the reasons you have to, when you interview your lawyer, one of the most important things you could ask that lawyer is their knowledge and familiarity with the system in which they're involved. If you're from Sacramento and you're going to try a case in Los Angeles and you get assigned to Judge A, and you don't know about Judge A, you're at a disadvantage. If they were to assign a case to me and you're being assigned to Judge B, and I know who that judge is by reputation because I belong to organizations, we all talk about it, whatever, you can ding that judge. You get one challenge.
Right.
And that you're not going to go in front of that judge. I've done it many times. But the real risk is if you ding somebody with your one challenge, the next person up could be as bad or worse than the one you just dinged.
Ding dong.
Yeah, in fact, Judge Bill Huss, who died a number of years ago, was an old friend of mine. He used to say to me, they had a system. If you dinged this one guy, you got the second guy automatic. And he was as worse.
Wow.
So you was no benefit to dinging anybody. So that's how the system works from the inside.
That's great. Great job today. Great show.
Well, it's the reality.
I'm just saying, it's awesome. Who knew?
How it worked. Let's see what happens tonight.
Oh, God.
We'll talk. Oh, by the way, next week what I'm going to do is I'm going to give people a sample case, a sample criminal case, first from the prosecution side, then I'll give it from the defense side, and then the public can be the judges. It's like a focus group.
Okay.
We're going to try like a mock jury, you know. So we're going to do one of those, and I got some very interesting stuff in those cases, and the jury can decide. They can be a lawyer for a minute.
Awesome. Sounds good.
Okay, we'll see you next week.
All right, and get the judge's book, From the Trench to the Bench. It's now available on Amazon.com. And check out his YouTube videos. Go to Judge Herb Dodell, and we have about 30 YouTube videos up there.
Yeah, and, you know, if you have any questions, I'm open to talk to you.
Ask Judge
cost
Herb.
Cost you nothing.
AskJudgeHerb@gmail.com. AskJudgeHerb@gmail.com. Judge, see you Monday, or Monday, I guess, not tomorrow.
Today's Monday.
I don't even
Where
know.
Where are you?
I had dental work. I had dental work today.
That's your excuse, huh? Is that why you're stumbling around?
No. I'll see you later. Have a great day.
Bye.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM. They said it really loud, they said it.
Why are you listening to this radio station? Why? When you can host your own radio show. You're listening and you think you can do better? You have a message or a product you want everyone to know about. Host your own radio show. Team up with the area's best radio professionals and let them make you sound like you should be on NBC. KCAA NBC Radio, that is. KCAA produces more than 50 local programs each week on subjects ranging from business and sports to political talk, vegan diets, or even marijuana-related issues. We don't just broadcast on the radio. We broadcast to the world, online, on TV, on social media, on Facebook. You'll be all over. Imagine what your friends will say. And KCAA reaches over 5 million people on 3 radio stations. Join the staff on 1050 AM, 102.3 FM, and 106.5 FM. NBC Radio. Jump on the KCAA Express. Call 909-793-1065. That's 909-793-1065. And get ready to transmit.
Are you having trouble sleeping? Are you always tired and worn out? Is it affecting your work and personal life? Well, South Pacific Sleep Lab can help you out. South Pacific Sleep Lab provides a personal study of your sleep patterns. With their trained specialists, they will diagnose your sleep habits and will give you a prognosis for getting a great, relaxing night of sleep. South Pacific Sleep Lab has locations throughout Southern California, including Fontana, and will provide transportation to any of their locations at no cost to you. To find out more, give them a call at 844-SAD-5050. That's 844-SAD-5050. South Pacific Sleep Lab. Start resting easy and sleeping sound today.
This segment is sponsored by Tammy Sutherland of Coldwell Banker Kivett Teeters Realty, where she makes it her business to put happy people in happy homes. It's Tammy Sutherland's passion to list your house and put you in just the right house that you could call home.
She made so much extra effort to sell our house and make sure that we understood every step of the way. Tammy always had our best interests at heart.
I didn't think we'd ever find a house we loved, but with Tammy's help, we did. Now I get to mow the lawn every weekend. But then again, that's why we had kids. Hey, Tyler!
Tammy did way more than we ever expected in a real estate agent. Without Tammy, we would still be renting.
So if you want your perfect house, contact Tammy Sutherland at Coldwell Banker Kivett Teeters Realty in Yucaipa, across from Yucaipa High School. Whether you're looking to buy or sell, it's homesbytammy.net or on Facebook at facebook.com/realtor Tammy Sutherland at 909-556-2094 for Realtor Tammy Sutherland, and we thank her for her support.
KCAA Radio is proud to announce that the Tri-City Center in Redlands is our new home. We're fortunate to be located among some of the best businesses in the region. Among our neighbors are Ray Chiropractic, Brace Connection Orthodontist, Pain Solutions Medical Massage, Rent-A-Center, MVP Staffing Agency, Jenny Craig, Salon Centric, and many more. The Tri-City Shopping Center is located just off the I-10, between Alabama and the Tennessee exits in Redlands. The Tri-City Center is the mall with a heart.
Now, here's a new concept. Digital network advertising, where businesses display your ad inside their building. If a picture's worth a thousand words, your company is going to thrive with digital network advertising. Choose your marketing sites or jump on the DNA system and advertise with all participants. Your business ad or logo is rotated multiple times an hour inside local businesses where people will discover your company. Digital network advertising. DNA, a novel way to be seen and remembered. Digital network advertising with networks in Redlands and Yucaipa. Call in the 909 area 222-9293 for introductory pricing. That's 909-222-9293 for digital network advertising. One last time, digital network advertising, 909-222-9293.
Here's Replete Vegan Skincare founder, Elizabeth Thoreau.
Investing in your beauty is investing in quality of your life. The secret is in Replete Spring Serum Complex. It puts elasticity back in your jawline contour for completely remodeling the effects of winter. It improves firmness. It gets rid of sagging and wrinkles. And it puts the smoothness, radiance, and freshness you want in a spring day.
RepleteSkincare.com for your skin to look and feel its best.
KCAA.
KCAA.
The following show is produced and distributed by the Gab Radio Network.
Welcome to the Sports Circus. I'm your ringmaster, Sal, here at Long Beach Lenny. Today's show is brought to you by Legal Shield, providing legal protection and peace of mind for less than a buck a day. Whether you got a ticket for speeding, texting and driving, a DUI, maybe someone punched you in the mouth, you need a cop, or you need a cop around, but then again, you may need a lawyer. For less than a dollar a day, folks, give the folks at Legal Shield a call, 213-245-1305. That's 213-245-1305. You can also visit them at nocourts.us. Again, give them a call, 213-245-1305, or go to nocourts.us. Make sure you tell them the circus sent you. Also, a big welcome to everybody listening in on iHeartRadio and our NBC Sports affiliates from coast to coast. And we also have a really special audience listening to us up in Seattle that we want to send a big Sports Circus hello to, as well as Anchorage, Alaska, and our friend Phil Shaheen over in Long Beach, sunny Southern California. All right there, Long Beach Lenny, what do you got for us?
Well, how about we step it into the ring, Sal? How about we say that UFC 226 out there at the T-Mobile Arena in Lost Wages, this was supposed to be an enormous fight, spectacular fight fest. And let me just say that the fix was in. Like, right from the very beginning, you have the champion, Stipe Miocic versus Daniel Cormier, a first-round knockout out of five-minute rounds. So this is supposed to be 25 minutes of brutal knockdown, drag-out fighting, and it ended up going down in a heap in the very first round. Now, you have to look at the size difference of these guys. You have to look at one guy being 5 inches taller, having an 8-inch reach advantage, and typically the champion, Stipe, would do this jabbing and pummeling and then getting him into the corner, but no. What he did was he clinched with him uncharacteristically, and then Daniel Cormier, DC, went ahead and clocked him with the right hand, got him down to the ground, a few punches, and it's all over. That, my friend, is not a good fight. That, my friend, does not constitute spending about 70 bones of your hard-earned money to see something like that, Sal.
Well, look at it this way. Maybe you say it was fixed. But then again, there's always the puncher's chance, and they could tag anybody at any point. All it takes is one hit. That's it. One hit. And, you know, you and I have had this situation. Me hitting you, you hitting the floor. And so that's all it takes sometimes. Now, just remember, even if somebody's got a 12-inch reach advantage and they're 9 foot 12, it doesn't matter.